Our last speaker is Mr. Eli Raz, my great friend from long ago. He is the expert of the Dead Sea area. He lives there, and he lives with it. So Eli is a geologist by training and also a biologist. He works now in the Israel Dead Sea Arava Science Center. And he has studied the Dead Sea sinkhole problem, which we just have seen. And his research interests are environmental change, accompanying the drop in the Dead Sea level, and enhancing the multidisciplinary studies for choosing the best solution for the Dead Sea crisis. So, Eli, please.
Okay.
The floor is yours.
Thank you, Uriel. Thank you, Yossi, for inviting me, in spite of the short time that you gave me to arrange myself. But never mind. The Dead Sea level is actually a dynamic equilibrium between the overall inflow to the lake and the evaporation. This is the only mean of losing water from the lake. And inflow and evaporation are, of course, climatic factors. And that's why climatic changes, which is in the core of this conference, influence the level of the Dead Sea a lot. But luckily, the historical Dead Sea had two basins, and the southern one, which is shallow, Okay, the southern basin is very shallow, not so much water, but occupies 40% of the evaporating area of the total water body. And in times where the of a shortage of water due to climatic change and the decrease in inflow, when the level dropped to 400 meters below sea level, a disconnection happened between the two basins, and no more water supply from the north to the south. In this case, instead of losing 40% by evaporation from the southern basin, actually the less 40% losing by evaporation compensated the decrease in the inflow. And in such a way, the level fluctuation was moderated. Now, watch carefully the changes along the twentieth century, and you see all the fluctuations are a little bit above, a little bit below 400 minus. Towards the 20th century, the situation was good, relatively. A lot of water came, and the level rised up. But soon after, men arrived and started to interfere in the water balance of the Dead Sea. And here you can see landmarks in the historical interference. In 1977, it was a disconnection between the two basins because the drop in the level to 4 minus. But unlike in the past, the industry decided to take an advantage of drying out the southern basin and turn it into evaporation pond in order to increase the production. In such a case, the Dead Sea lost its buffer and water are pumped from the northern basin to the southern one in spite of being very low, the level. So this is a big change. Now, zoom in to the last four decades, you can see that the level lost about 40 meters, which is quite a rapid rate. And lakes as a whole are very delicate ecosystem, and the drop in the level is accompanied by a lot of undesirable phenomena. Just to see the impact, you see a picture from 1939 of the jetty in the northern tip of the Dead Sea, the Palestine potash factory, actually, and a picture that I took about 60 years later, the same jetty, and you can see where is the water line. Not today, but 25 years ago. Another example is the jetty of a naval basis in Engedi. Now it's, of course, abandoned. Maybe the Air Force will be show interest in it. And here are the sinkholes that were already mentioned here. I am not going to explain the sinkholes formation along the Dead Sea. We have a special excursion tomorrow, if you have appropriate insurance, of course. So just to show you the impact of and damages of the sinkholes is a terrible situation. Nowadays, there is no any access to the Dead Sea shore of the northern basin because of sinkholes. And a lot of projects are abandoned, absolutely. And even master plans are suspended. And this is a very, very bad situation. Now, another impact is the increase of the erosion potential of downstreams, which brings damages to infrastructures like bridges. Flash flood is a very, very impressive phenomenon, and people are coming to see flash floods, and the best place to see it is on the bridge, of course. But people who stood on the bridge, they heard suddenly strange noises, and here you can see after 10 minutes what happened to the bridge. Another impact is ecological one. The interface between the groundwater and the Dead Sea water in the subsurface is sinking and chasing, follows the receding Dead Sea. As long as the drop of the interface was within the range of the coarse pebble, nothing happened. On the contrary, most area exposed, but the groundwater irrigated larger area. So the authorities, the Nature Reserve authorities, were very satisfied by the expansions of the coastal nature reserves. But it was too early to be happy, because here you can see my prediction later on when the interface reached the fine grade material, which not allowed to the interface to sink anymore down, the water had to flow on the surface in streams, and the water potential didn't decrease, but the water now passing through hypersaline media, and they emerge in quite different structure, and which is absolutely bound. Now, another problem is that sub-aquifers, as you can see here an example, were blocked and prevented to flow the water to the lake because of the pressure of the water column. But since after the drop in the level, the pressure is much lower, and water can be released from sub-aquifers, and by that to bypass the reserves from below, which, of course, another very negative impact. We are witness today to a change, enormously change, in the variety of species. And who knows what will be the continuation of these changes. Now, the habitats of the Dead Sea Springs were blessed by high number of endemic species, and nobody knows today what happened with the endemic species. You can just see the concern of the UI IUCN invented with the data book. Here you see a quotation from the book itself. And of course, these habitats are under a threat. Now, the question for how long it will be continue, we can make calculation. Here you can see prediction of future balance of dead seawater as a consequence of the inflow, amount of inflow. Today we are standing about here, a little bit less, and the level of the drop in the level will continuously, quite rapidly, at least during the following 200 years. And then it will be more moderate, but after 500 years, we can achieve a stabilization. So everything will be okay, we just have to be patient. And the level will be 550 minus. Today we have more accurate calculations, but this is the idea as a whole. Now, the sinkholes formation study waked up the government from a deep freeze, and Prime Minister Sharon that time decided and managed to have a governmental decision to check carefully what's happening in the sea and what if this should be interfered by the government or to let it going down. Business as usual. And of course, to check different scenarios, how to treat the problem, which is, of course, the deficit in water. And unfortunately, we worked about 2 weeks on this document. You can see here the cover, but it was interrupted after Prime Minister left his position. And in the front page of this booklet, we put the cry to the government to accomplish the work because we don't have any good answer. We have the whole data, but we cannot reach the point of giving a reasonable solution. Now, and the other government chose to neglect the previous decision. Decided to support the demand of Jordan with the support of the World Bank to check only one option, which called the dead red conduit. Now, these are the rationale of the project. And this is the schematic sketch of the idea. To pump water from the Red Sea, to elevate it to 230 plus, and to let the water flow and to let it down in order to desalinate it by the gravitation with the method of opposite osmosis. Allocation to Palestine, 270 million cubics per year, and to Jordan, 530, altogether 800 million cubic meter per year, but desalinating in this method, you have more byproduct, which is marine brines, and it was intended to enter to the Dead Sea in order to block or to moderate the fall of the level. But the problem is, and there are some problems, I show it here, first of all, introduction of a big amount of dissolved salt in different chemical composition doesn't promise any good. Of course, a threat upon the vulnerable ecosystem of the Gulf of Aqaba. Current is the main factor in the marine ecosystem. And speaking about 2 billion cubic meter per year of pumping, and of course, a threat of seawater leakage along the conduit, which will spoil the soils and salt the aquifer. Seawater contamination is a big concern. Mixing seawater with dead seawater might form gypsum crystallization, according to the equation that you can see here. And of course, in addition, a bloom of bacteria, which will damage will have a very bad impact on the tourism. Now, the density and the frequency of earthquakes between Red Sea and Dead Sea are the highest in the region. It is exactly the route of the future canal. And in addition, the tectonics, because of the movement, the lateral movement of the eastern side northwards, the friction creates the earthquakes, and there are secondary geological faults. This is the main fault. This is the border, and this is the root of the project, and all the dark lines here are secondary faults. Now, part of them are marked in red color. You see it here in the Israeli side. This color reflects a monitored movement on the faults. Well, of course, there is a bilateral symmetry between the two sides in spite of nothing was documented here because of the, I think they didn't have the right instruments to document it that time. But you can assume that part of the faults are active. So here you can see in purple the cross between faults and the root of the tunnel, which is of course a cause for concern, leakage, damage, and protecting of such a project is a very, very expensive if it is possible at all. Now, we know exactly the direction of the water, the groundwater in the Arava Valley from the east to the west, exactly to the boreholes all along the border. You see boreholes, the blue dots in both sides of the border, and this will be, if it will happen, the end of the agriculture in the Arava Valley on both sides. Here you can see the difference between differences in the chemistry composition, especially notice the relative part of the calcium in the Dead Sea, which is much, much bigger than in ordinary seawater. And on the other hand, the low part of the sulfate in comparison to the sulfate in the seas, which means the mixture of the two water bodies will create gypsum, which is the end, not the end, but very harmful to the industry, and probably will create whitening, white color on the water, which is an optical effect, and maybe also will damage the tourism, of course. But long time ago, people like me and others spoke about the big mistake to build the project based on mixture of two absolutely different water bodies. And eventually, and too late maybe, a study was carried in order to check this problem. And eventually, you can see it in the final report of the World Bank, no way to enter to the Dead Sea more than 400, 500 million cubic meters per year of brines or seawater without changing absolutely the qualities of the lake. Now, everybody knows that we cannot fulfill the ambitious project of the Red Dead, of course, not in the amount that they intended to do. If we are speaking about 400 or 500 or maybe 600 million cubes per year, the original intention was to enter 1.25 billion cubic meters per year. And this is absolutely impossible, unless we decide to kill totally the Dead Sea. Here you can see the development of a lot of threats, bacterial bloom, algal bloom, crystallization of gypsum, etc. Now, Jordan shortage of potable water should be a main constraint also of Israel, not for the Jordanians. Okay. And that's why we have to check other options rather than the late Red Dead, because it is not feasible at all. Now, desalination is a very important player on the ground, and there is another options to bring potable water, like transportation from places where are enough water. And here you can see the actual situation of the system. A pump pumping water to the national water conveyor. The Ganya dam is blocking and preventing any downstream. And the Dead Sea, of course, the level is falling down. Kinneret water quality is continually reduced because of the dam and the pumping from here. And nowadays, we cannot use the capacity of the national conveyor. Nowadays, they have to mix desalinated water with Kinneret water because of the quality. And on the other hand, we can see a big advance of desalination. Now you can see the plants along the Dead Sea, the Mediterranean seashore. Now they produce half billion a year of desalinated water, which is about 25% of the total demand of water. So, of course, there is disadvantages in desalination, air pollution, etc. But we have to take into consideration everything. Now, it is very important to have a systemic approach because Dead Sea is not the only one link in the chain. We have to think about the whole chain. And to give a comprehensive and systemic solution. Now, in this offer is, first of all, to not to supply any more water from the Kinneret to the coastal plain, to substitute the water by desalinated water, and then immediately you can revive the Jordan River by the same water that was sent to the coastal plain. Most of the experts agree with this, not to pump any more water from the Kinneret. By that, we improve the lake's water and make it more manageable, stopping the salting of the soils and aquifer in the coastal plain, release water downstream in order to recover the Jordan River ecosystem for ecotourism, for pilgrimage, etc. Now, if we can, and it will be, the conditions will be okay, and the ability to desalinate more water, gradual increase of desalination and or import according to the economic and environmental constraints. Desalinated water will be directed to Lake Kinneret by the National Water Conveyor, but opposite direction from here to the Kinneret, and to release as much as we can water from the lake to the needs of the Jordanians, and if we have extra water to the Jordan River and to the Dead Sea in order to moderate the fall. Lake Kinneret will serve the riparian entities as a manageable operative reservoir. It is very important for the Jordanians because the problem is not just the shortage in water, but also the absence of any reservoir to store water from good year to bad year. So why not offer them to use the Kinneret for this purpose? Now, after several works, it crossed my mind that there is many, maybe better option for the upper part of the project. Here you can see the national conveyor. You can see the profile, pumps here in the Kinneret, Lake Kinneret, pumping the water, passing the canyon of Amud, and then passing another canyon of Salmon. Now they need another pump here because the power is not enough to pump it to Ilabun, and from there to the Bet Netofa Valley. And from here to spread it along, now what I offer to check, I'm not sure that it will be successful or feasible, but the idea is to desalinate the water on the seashore on Haifa Bay, to pump it 20 kilometers and 150 meters high to meet the conveyor here, to pour the water into the storage, which is here, and to lower a little bit the threshold here near Ilabun by a few meters, and from here and then all the water will flow by the power of gravity, and the pumps will turn to be hydroelectric power engines. So this project is, of course, this is the charm of this project is this is the shorter option and hence the cheaper one, and does not need any tunnels, the most expensive component in every Suez Canal. And most of the structure, substructure exists, and a lot of elements are exist. And so few, the advantages are quite clear of the systemic Gemarty, quite clear of the systemic approach. Here you can see them. And I'm not saying that this project is absolutely feasible, but to my opinion, it deserves a feasibility study, not less than the late RSDS conduit project. And if we will listen to the cry of the Dead Sea, maybe we will see the real recovery of the system of the Lake of Galilee, the Jordan River, and the Dead Sea. Thank you very much.